hacking is the art of breaking security mechanisms. When I was an undergraduate student, I worked as a hacker in a computer security firm. We used to be hired by banks and credit card services to conduct penetration tests, to try to find critical gaps in the security of these banks and develop better measures. Let me show you one of my favorite hacks. Here is the younger version of me, and behind me you can see the door to the IT department of a major bank in Israel. This door is controlled by an intercom. That's a very simple device. You press on a button, it calls the secretary, and if she knows you, she would press 8 on her telephone, and the door will open. What I'm going to show you is that each one of you can open this door in 5 seconds by playing the sound 8 from your own cell phone just next to the intercom. Let's see how it goes. Currently, it is 10 p.m., no secretary there. Okay. Calling the secretary. No one is there. Playing 8. And taking the money. Don't try this at home. Okay. After a few years of working as a hacker, I graduated, switched fields to genetics, and eventually became a professor of computational genomics. In genomics, we don't have banks, but I found that we have biobanks. These registries collect and store the DNA of many individuals to have access, to give access for scientists. And they can get to a very large scale. For instance, here is the biobank in Norway that stores the DNA of 500,000 individuals. Scientists can use the DNA to understand the genetic basis of different types of disorders, such as heart disease, cancer, or psychiatric illnesses. Once we know the genetic basis, we can now offer help for patients. We can offer them early diagnosis and intervention. To illustrate how this process might look like, I want to show you a short scene from the futuristic movie Gattaca. In this scene, there is a newborn, and the doctors are going to collect blood from this newborn and analyze his DNA immediately to know all the predispositions in the first moments of his life. Let's see how it goes.
10 fingers, 10 toes, that's all that used to matter. Not now. Now, only seconds old, the exact time and cause of my death was already known.
Now they take the DNA and start to analyze the predispositions.
Neurological condition, 60% probability. Manic depression, 42% probability. Attention deficit disorder, 89% probability. Heart disorder, 99% probability.
So now if we know that this baby has a 99% probability for heart disorder, we can intervene early, maybe by a drug, by a surgery, maybe in the future by CRISPR. So although Gattaca is a futuristic movie, this scene highlights that DNA can reveal a lot of information about diseases. And that might be sensitive for some of you. So biobanks developed security measures to protect the identity and the privacy of their participants. When scientists access the DNA in these biobanks, they don't get the name or the contact information of these people. They only get access to the DNA with some basic demographic information, such as where the sample was collected or what is the age of the person, but the identity remains anonymous. Being a hacker, I wondered if this security mechanism is good, and I wanted to try to hack it and to see if I can breach the privacy of these participants. So my lab conducted an empirical test. We took a DNA sample from a US biobank. Now, since this person could match anyone in the US, the initial search space was the entire US population, over 300 million individuals. Then we started to work with the demographic identifiers to narrow down the search space. We knew that the sample came from Utah, which has a population of 3 million individuals. Then we discovered that the sample has a Y chromosome, meaning that this is a male, which halved the search space to about 1.5 million individuals. And then, based on demographic information, we knew that this person is 49 years old, which reduced the search space to 20,000 individuals. By this point, we exhausted all the demographic identifiers. We still had 20,000 people, and we didn't know who is the person. We were stuck. But then we thought about this really, really, really cool hack. We found that we can infer the surname of the person just by looking at the DNA. Let me show you how it works. Consider here the Kovach family. Now, let's assume that they have a son, and the father will give his son his Y chromosome and also his surname. Now, if this son is getting married and also has a son, he will give him his Y chromosome and also his surname. So you see, this creates a correlation between the specific Y chromosome in this Kovach family and between the surname. Genetic genealogy companies take advantage over this correlation, and they offer services where they will send you a swab to sample the DNA in your cheek. You put it in an envelope with $99, very important, and send it to them. They will analyze your Y chromosome and your surname and will put it in an open database such as ysearch.org. This website is open for every one of you without subscription, so you can look at the data in this website. Many people do these tests just because they want to learn about their ancestry. They want to find their relatives or maybe meet the black sheep in their family. So with this database right now, there are over 170,000 records of surnames and Y chromosomes. So going back to our allegedly anonymous sample, we took the Y chromosome of this individual and searched this database. And eventually we found a match to another Y chromosome. Since these two Y chromosomes were identical, we also knew that the surnames should match each other. So now we are able to infer the surname of this anonymous person, which I'm going to term Mr. X, just to respect his privacy. Now we had a surname, and with the surname, we reduced the search space from 20,000 individuals all the way to a single individual, only one person. At this point, we knew the identity of this person, his first name and last name. We knew his Facebook profile, email address, contact information, where he lives. All of these were connected with his genomic information with all these predispositions. Just to show that this process really works, we repeated this analysis over and over again with more samples, and were able to breach the privacy of close to 50 different participants. We had their entire genome and full name and contact information. And we're very pleased to see that this study generated a lot of media attention because we wanted to start a dialogue between scientists, biobanks, and the general public about how we should move forward. And I want to emphasize that this issue is not just a problem for the US biobank, also for other biobanks around the world. So it also generated some attention from the international media. So you know what? Maybe we should just dismantle all these biobanks. They cannot protect our privacy. Their security measures don't work. Maybe we should just shut them down. Maybe we should not go so fast. Let me tell you what is at stake. I would like you to meet Ariela. Ariela is an adorable little girl that was born with facial malformation. During her childhood, she developed brain cancer. And her family contacted my lab to see if we can help. We sequenced Ariela's genome, and we're able to pinpoint the mutation that caused this facial malformation and quite likely also induced her cancer status. Today, Ariela is healthy. This photo was taken 2 weeks ago in her bat mitzvah celebration in Israel. She's doing great. Without biobanks, we will not be able to help Ariela. The whole process relied on analyzing, the whole process of finding this mutation in your genome relied on analyzing thousands of genomes of healthy individuals from these biobanks and contrasting these results with the genome of Ariela. So biobanks are highly important for advancements in biomedical research, for families like Ariela, but also for other types of diseases. So thinking a lot about this tension between data sharing and privacy, I realize that in many cases, when people say, I want my privacy, in many cases they tell us, I don't trust you with my data. So instead of fixing privacy, which might be quite hard, we should focus on establishing trust relationships between scientists and participants. And when we have trust, we can do great things. Let me show you how it works in practice. This website is called DNA Land. We put this website a few months ago, And the aim of this website is to crowdsource genomic information from the general public. We launched this website in October, and since then, we collected close to 22,000 genomes, about 3,000 genomes every month, or 100 genomes every day. And we do that because we have trust relationships. How do we get to these trust relationships? We return individuals useful and interesting information when they upload their genome to our website. For example, we analyze for each genome the ancestry composition of this individual. What you see over here is the DNA length results for my own genome. I'm half Ashkenazi Jew, and you can see that in my red, big red segment in my genome. And my mother's side is from the Jewish community in Uzbekistan, and these are the other segments that reflect my maternal line. We do it for every genome, and then people feel that we reciprocate. We give them something back, and this creates these relationships. In addition, to create trust, we want to have this dialogue with the community. And to have this dialogue, we are very pleased to see that people in our community put together a Facebook page, and they did it on their own initiative, to discuss the results that they get from DNA land, to help each other with this information, and also we can go and tell them what we do with their data. And this is part, basically, when we go to this website, we can show them what is in their genome, and we can tell them about their science that we have over there, creating these trust relationships. In addition, we want to lead the community. I want to serve as an example for the community, and I also share my own genome online, because I want to signal people that if they give me their genome, I want to also show them my own test results. And I want to encourage each one of you to consider sharing your genomic information and participating in such studies. Think about it, each one of you is going to be sick at some point in your lifetime. Worse, our loved ones might be sick, our kids, our spouses, our parents. And when they're sick, we want them to give the best clinical care that is available. With genomics, we can understand the blueprints of different human maladies. We can develop better treatments, and we can really open a new chapter in biomedical research. But this cannot happen without our participation. So I want to encourage each one of you to contribute your genome. Thank you very much.